Well, hello there. This is Adam. Today we're going to learn about interpersonal communication, knowing yourself and others, from this PowerPoint that I stole from a class that I used to teach. That's why the numbers don't match up. You're not in a different class, don't worry. Anyhow, so interpersonal communication. This is a real thing. Usually when you think of a public speaking class, you think of like, I'm going to give a talk, but we are covering all manners of communication in this class because we don't mess around. And one of them is like, how do you navigate relationships with other people in the workplace and, you know, even at home? And the way that you do that is through communication. It's probably the foundational aspect of all relationships that you have, unless you just hang out with people that you don't talk to, which could be a thing. I don't know. But anyway, so let's talk about our objectives. Whoa, look at that flying action, man. I've been shafting you all on like the animation so far this semester. I'm gonna make up for it in this PowerPoint. Oops, just kidding. So identify the three factors that influence relationships and initiation. So why do we even form relationships to begin with? There are three things, apparently. Investigate interpersonal communication skills. We're gonna actually give you little test here where you're gonna get to find out a little bit about yourself in terms of your communication style in relationships. And then we're gonna talk about ways that you can flex, in air quotes, your individual style to reduce tension in relationships. So think about where you work. There are probably people who have a different style than you in terms of their personality and communication style. And so how do you get along with them? So yeah, all right, let's get right into it. So according to relationship theory, there are, that's a thing I just made up, relationship theory. There are three factors that most influence relationships. And I should back up a little bit. Relationships of any sort are initiated by attraction, right? So there's something that draws you to that other person for whatever reason makes you want to be friends or talk to them. And the theory is that there are three factors that most influence this attraction. So not, you know, the only thing, obviously, but the three things that most influence it. The first one is proximity, right? You're probably friends with the people that you see on a regular basis best, or you're gonna work with the people that you happen to be across the hall from. So that's a thing. You generally don't strike up relationships with people, you know, far-flung areas. Maybe you do on the internet these days, who knows, but probably not as often as the people that you know from just being around. The other one is attractiveness, which can be interpreted broadly. In a personal relationship, this may be like physical attractiveness or some kind of charisma or whatnot. If it's at work, it could also just be somebody that knows stuff, you know, that you find that, you know, like a mentoring relationship, for example. So, and then the last one is similarity, right? So how much are you alike with this person? Can you get along with them? Those kinds of things. All right, let's move on. So relationships are an important aspect of life, and they are based on the ability to effectively communicate with others. And basically, there are four competing theories or approaches for that sort of give insight to how relationships develop and change over time. And they are social penetration theory, stage models, the turning point approach, which is my favorite because it just sounds like a it sounds like a daytime soap opera, sort of the turning point. Anyway, and then the dialectical theory, which anytime that you see that word, it just means to talk back and forth. All right, so let's do this. Social penetration theory. This is a theory that says basically that communication or self-disclosure, right, to the amount to which you share about yourself is the key to relationship development. And it's determined by three things. So breadth, like the number of things. Think of your best friend. You can probably talk about anything, right? So you got great breadth there in terms of, you know, the number of topics that you can cover, the number of things that you're connected on. But you probably also have great depth. So maybe you've shared with them like your deepest personal feelings, et cetera, et cetera. And then also frequency. So this is probably a person that you're around often or probably, you know, talk to often on the phone or Snapchat or whatever you kids do these days. So those are the three things that sort of say, like, we look at these three things and we say the greater these three things, the more apt you are to have a better relationship with the person. And the less things, the least likely you are to have a good relationship with the person. So if you can't talk about very much, you don't feel like disclosing too much from them and you rarely see them, probably not your bestie, right? All right, cool, let's move on. So stage models. This is according to Altman and Taylor, and they basically, it's a four-step thing that you move through in relationships, right? So the first one is like orientation, so what we call superficial exchange. This is where you would talk small talk, like we learned about last week, right? So just things to sort of, you know, get you off and running and talking about the weather or like what you do at work or just kind of silly stuff that eases you in and you decide that this person isn't crazy and you like them and et cetera. And then you can move on to what we call the exploratory affective exchange. And that's sort of a breath exchange. This is the stage at which you are sort of, you know, sussing out all the things that you have in common, right? Like, I didn't know that you went to that high school. You enjoy sailing too. I didn't know you'd been to Cancun, like those kinds of things, right? And then you, once you've established like the range of things that you can talk about and communicate on, then you move into the affective exchange. And this is where you, you know, sort of continue to increase breadth, but also depth and frequency, right? So it ties in some of that last theory. And just you can think about it as the place at which you start to maybe open up a little bit more. And so that's, you know, you're not just that you went to Cancun, but also that's where you lost your boyfriend, you know, et cetera. I'm having a great time here. I hope you all too. Anyway, and then the last one is stable exchange, right? So greatest breadth and depth. And this is a, like sort of like a plateau phase in the relationship where you're just at a good point. So, all right, cool. This is my favorite, the turning point approach. And even though these are in two different columns, they're supposed to be all one thing. And so basically, romantic relationships, this is the one that is strictly romantic. The other ones could apply to work relationships too. Move both toward and away from commitment over the course of relationships. So think about a continuum. And on the left-hand side, where we start in the get-to-know-you phase, is the least amount of commitment. And on the far right side, down there by sacrifice, is the most amount of commitment. And so generally, you'll move through these. Sometimes you can skip steps, but they usually go in order, and you can move forward or backwards at any time, right? So there's the get-to-know-you phase, there's the quality phase. Hey, let's hang out sometime, okay? There's the physical separation phase. This is the point at which you could start to move backwards. So like we're separated, absence makes the heart grow fonder or forgetful. And then, you know, the long time, long distance boyfriend is gone. There could be passion. There could be disengagement. This is like an emotional roller coaster. there could be exclusivity. All right. So like we're making it official. Perhaps it's on Facebook. There could be negative psychic damage or change rather, not damage, negative psychic change. Like you just kind of have like a bad feeling about this relationship. Yeah. There could be making up. All right. That's good. There could be serious commitment and then ultimately sacrifice, right? So like you are so committed to this person, you're willing to like give stuff up to be with them. And so, and again, I said phases and stages, really these are sort of different like triggering points or points on this continuum. And so you can move through them and, you know, so if you started to do get to know you, you're moving forwards towards commitment, quality time, towards commitment. Oh, maybe there's physical separation. You're back towards not commitment, but then there could be passion. You're back towards commitment. See where we're going here? Okay, great. The dialectical theory, which just means again, to talk to people, basically says, or dialectic is just, it's a word that means like an exchange or a tension between two things, you know? And so usually it's used in like language and discourse theory, which I won't go into. Anyway, so this one says basically you're going to have the good relationship with the person who is able to navigate the tension that you feel between contradictory things. So autonomy versus connection. This is, I'm a strong, independent person, but also I need you to love me. And so the person that can navigate that best is gonna be the person with which you have better relationships. Expressiveness versus privacy, same concept, right? Like I just really enjoy spending time with you and sharing, but also please don't call me for 3 days because I gotta, like I'm on a vision quest. Anyway, and then change versus predictability, right? So some people, they really enjoy change and stuff, and others, they just, you know, are ready to you know, they want to know what's up. And so the person that can balance this and sort of navigate this tension with you is going to be the person that you're in the best relationship with. Okay. All right. So this is the point at which you should pause the video, if you have not done so already, and go and do the insight inventory. It's on the Canvas site. There's like a questionnaire. It takes a little while because there's math. And so you answer the questions and you go back and you communicate the score sheet and it will tell you where you're at. So ready, go, do the thing. Okay, welcome back. So reasons for communication failures. There could be language barriers, right? All right, and actually I got a good video for this. Let's see if it'll do it. Sorry, it's real
das
small.
Das hier ist mein Sektor.
Das hier ist das wichtigste Gerät des Küstenwächters.
Das Gerät und das Gerät.
Überlebensradar.
Hello? This is the German Coast Guard.
We're thinking.
What are you thinking about?
That's pretty good, right? I don't even know that Germany has a coast. Do they? I don't know. We should look at a map. All right, there's also poor listening skills, i.e. selective hearing, right? Like you hear what you want to hear. And I have a video for this too.
Donkey.
Treats? Yeah, that's what I thought.
Dogs are dumb. Okay, the last one. Differences in communication preferences. That was really awkward. Also, I love that that was in French and they were playing Walking on Sunshine. Anyway, so you see there are a couple different communication failures going on in these videos, and you know, these and many more could happen to you in real life. So here is your sort of personality profile. It's also missing some letters. So we're going to talk through this, right? So hopefully you've done this by now during our little video interlude, and you've plotted this out, and you know that you can be some manner of indirect to direct, reserved to outgoing, urgent to steady, and then unstructured to more structured. And so this one actually isn't me, mine's at the end, but anyhow, so cool. So when we think about the things that you got going on here, right? So the first sort of measure is your sort of way of communication in terms of getting your way, right? Are you really indirect? Are you maybe a little bit more passive about, you know, like this is a person who would sort of hint at what they want, drop some subtle clues. Whereas if you're more direct, you would be like, I want you to take me to dinner. And so you could also respond to people, right, in the B category there. This measures the way that you enjoy communicating with people, right? So you can be more reserved. So these are like your more introverted people and more outgoing, so more extroverted people. Hopefully if you've taken like Myers-Briggs or something, this, hopefully has synced up with your Myers-Briggs score as well. There's pacing activity, right? Some people are fairly, laid back and steady. For them, this is the concept of manana comes in there, like, you know, tomorrow, like we'll get to it eventually, versus urgent, you know, like we need to do the thing right now. I put off till tomorrow what you can do today. And then finally, the way that you would deal with details, right? So are you very unstructured? Are you like the 30,000 foot big picture view? Or are you more detail oriented and precise? So we're going to kind of talk through this here in a little bit. So whenever you do, holy cow, look at these lines. So basically, this is just explaining that the darker, depending on where your little points are, the darker you are, the more serious it is. The lighter you are, the less serious it is. And in the middle, you're kind of in the middle. So anyhow, so other things to know is that there are basically two profiles. People tend to differ at their work style versus their personal style, right? And this is a weird thing because this is like, I'm personally the same everywhere I go. Like if you get me at work, I'm exactly the same out of work. And whenever I took the test, it actually kind of bears that out. But for most people, this is you, you probably have like internalized the way that people should function at work. And so your work style is probably a little different from the way that you function at home. And so that's just a thing to know. Whenever you think about the differences between the two, sometimes like it can cause stress, right? So there's some long-term adjustments that are in there. Like if you like have sort of competing like ways that you do things at home versus at work, like it can just cause stress over time. Anyway, just work with me here. And then I'm just gonna skip these. Like I'm trying to think of like a good story here and I can't come up with one. So we'll come back to this. All right. So getting your way. This is the first one. This is the A category. So this is how you get things done, get results, assert yourself. If you're more indirect, you tend to be more diplomatic with people. You're more tactful. You're more conscious of other people's feelings. You're maybe a little more approachable and unassuming. You're agreeable. You will ask people to do something versus telling them to do something. Probably a little bit more modest and subtle. You prefer to negotiate, like if there's something coming on. So you can see how this paints a picture of a person who, you know, isn't necessarily a pushover. That's not what we're saying, because I tend to be an indirect person. But that they have a different way of going about, you know, getting people to do what they want. And so this is probably you're much more like relational oriented person. On the other hand, your direct person, and maybe you know somebody like this, is very straightforward, right, about what they want. They're just very assertive, frank, forceful, and self-assured. They can be challenging to people sometimes, as opposed to trying to be agreeable and easy to get along with. They're, you know, rather than trying to negotiate like a peaceable solution that everybody's happy on, they want to debate and win. You know, they're generally pretty confident. They're more apt to tell you to do something versus to ask. And so maybe you're one or the other, right? Like maybe, you know, hopefully you, you know, like your where you plot it out works out okay. Yeah, all right, cool. So the next one, responding to people, B. So this is how you approach other individuals or groups of people, right? So if you're the reserved person, if this is you, again, this is me, you're quiet, you enjoy one-on-one relationships. You are sort of private and self-contained. You enjoy spending time by yourselves. Whenever it comes time to sort of think of solutions to problems, you prefer to work it out by yourself. We also have another sort of thing that we talk about in the social sciences because it's called an external processor versus an internal processor. And so like you probably know the external processor because they're always talking and they're like, oh, I just needed to talk this out. This is the opposite of that. This is the person that needs for that person to shut up so that they can think about the problem in peace. So maybe that's you. They tend to use fewer gestures, actually, believe it or not. And then they minimize like contact with people. So I actually enjoy people. I just also like being by myself. Anyway, this isn't about me. And then the other one is outgoing, right? So you could, this is the extroverted. You're talkative. You enjoy working in groups. You're sort of open and expressive. You prefer to talk about problems like out loud, again, like an external processor. Like you just have to, these are people that are fun to go to meetings with at least, because at least their entire internal monologue is narrated aloud so that you understand exactly where they're at. Sometimes I think that like this is why people who are extroverted are tend to be perceived as leaders, because they where people who are quieter are a little more harder to parse because they're working out all the problems internally, but the other people are working out the problems externally and people see them as solving problems. You know, but just because it's out in front of them and they perceive extroverts as being more of a leader. Anyway, that was a brief aside. Lots of gestures, contact with others often. The other thing to think about too, this is just another Adam tidbit for you all. We tend to think about like, sometimes people will say, like on the introvert to extrovert spectrum, they'll say, oh, like introverts draw their energy from being alone. And that's dumb. Like that's, I think that was the way that people thought for a long time. One of the better ways that I've had it described put forward is that Everybody enjoys being around people and being alone to varying degrees. And what causes that degree is determined by your sort of like homeostasis level of stimuli, okay? So if you have a very low threshold for stimuli, whenever you are around a lot of people, it takes a lot away from you. And so when you're by yourself, it moves you back towards that homeostasis. Where the other way is if you're more extroverted, you tend to have a higher threshold of stimuli that you need. And whenever you're by yourself, it draws away, from that, and you get sad. So anyway, I always thought that was a better way to get it, that rather than we're recharging, really what you're doing is just trying to get back to whatever your normal stasis is, naturally. Anyway, all right, cool. So number C, letter C, the pacing activity. So how you burn energy, the pace or rhythm with which you move about the world. Again, if you're more urgent, you tend to decide things quickly, you change readily, you're restless, you hate to wait. You consider a few options and then decide. You prefer short-term projects that you can, finish them and move on to the next. You move on opportunities pretty quickly, right? Like if there's something that comes up, like this is the person that jumps on it, right? They're decisive, bold, et cetera, et cetera. All right, if you're more on the steady side, you still get stuff done, but you get it done in a different way. So you're more likely to deliberate, to consider things. You are a little bit more hesitant to change, probably a little more easygoing. You're okay to let things come to you sometimes. You consider many options and then decide. Sometimes you have to overthink stuff. And you do well with long extended projects because you're not restless and jumpy to move on to the next thing. And so you can actually stick with some pretty, long projects. And you are seeking an ideal timing. So not necessarily there's an opportunity, I better jump on it right now. You tend to appreciate whenever the right thing comes along at the right time, and you're okay waiting for that to happen. Does that make sense? Great, cool. Now the last one, D, dealing with the details. So how you deal with your world, order and handle details, right? So this could be, if you're unstructured, what you're really looking for is to seek flexibility. You do as your needs dictate, right? You readily use non-conventional methods, unpredictable plans. You're frustrated by the rules. this is definitely me. You work well without guidelines and you delegate details, right? And so if you're the opposite of this, you tend to see these as being bad things, but I really want to challenge you to look and say all right, this type of person is good for particular situations, right? Because we sometimes we need people to be flexible. If you have a person that's 100% rigid and has to have it their way, or they have a meltdown, that person doesn't do well in situations that don't conform exactly to their standards, right? You probably know this person, right? They're the person that has their meals scheduled out in an Excel sheet for the next month, and if you ask them to lunch, they have a meltdown. This is a real person that I know. I won't name names. Anyway, so that's unstructured. If you're more precise or more structured is probably what they should have said. You're trying to seek order and establish a plan. You want to know what's happened, you organize and prioritize. You prefer tried and true over conventional methods. You have clear set plans. You like rules and systems because it tells you how to act and you know what to expect. And you don't like it when there aren't guidelines, right? And so you can see how this person would be great for certain tasks and situations, but maybe not for others. All right, so here's a question for you. You can answer to yourself. What are the three strengths that you possess? What are three strengths that you possess? And then we think about then how do we apply them at work, right? So when you think about the things that bring us stress, strengths, crap. Usually if I had more time when I screw up like this, I would go back and re-record the video, but you just get all the outtakes this time. I hope you're enjoying this behind the scenes at Adam's recording studio. Anyway, so every environment, whether it be at work or at home, has certain pressures, stresses that are particular to that particular place. I love how it says that girl is at home, but she's definitely in some terrible workplace kitchen where nobody ever cleans and everybody steals your sandwiches. There are role expectations, which just means that, people expect you to do certain things at work and they expect you to behave differently at home. There are behavior inhibitors. So people like peer pressure will keep you in check in certain ways. So for example, you know, that person that, you know, has the Excel file of her meals for the rest of the month, would probably go even further and run amok planning out everybody else's details of their life on an Excel file if there weren't those behavior inhibitors, like, you know, social pressures that say, no, this is weird, don't do that. And so they know that they gotta like only do that for them. Anyhow, and then also behavior encouragers. So there's other, you know, the same forces work to you know, make you do other things. But all right, so here's what we do. Whenever we're thinking about stress, depending on how you scored on your insight inventory, whether you're more direct, more indirect, etc., you have default actions. So whenever you stress, if you are stressed or put in a stressful situation, if you're more indirect, your default reaction is to avoid and give in. Whereas if you're, you know, more direct, your default is to argue and push back, right? And so you can see, like, whenever you are in a situation, like say with a direct person, and you know that they're stressed out, the probably the best, you know, like, it's good to at least be able to know that if they're stressed out and you push them, this is probably the response that you're going to get. So it helps to have these sort of levels to be able to size people up so that you can try to predict their behavior in your head. If you're reserved, you're more likely to withdraw and not talk. If you're outgoing, you're more likely to talk too much, right? So if you're that extroverted person that gets nervous, all of a sudden they're talking like crazy. If you're urgent, you get more impatient and more impulsive. If you're steady, you'll delay too long and stall. If you're unstructured, you'll, you know, tend to, you know, in a stressful situation, you'll drop the details and bend the rules to suit your needs. And then if you're more precise, or more structured, you know, and it gets really stressful, you know, say you're planning an event, and it's got to go just right, you know, then you become like a control freak and get perfectionistic and try to control everything. So maybe this is, hopefully whenever we're going through this, you're like, oh my God, I totally do that. That's what I'm hoping for here. So what is your initial/most common reaction to stress? What I'm challenging you to do here is to think about how you react, like in stressful situations based on your score. I tend to avoid and give in, talk too much, delay too long and stall, and then drop details and bend rules. Those are my things that I do that are bad. And so what you need to do is to then think about like how to not overuse those. Like whenever you see yourself starting to default, stop and think about what you're doing. That shirt's really old because it says anyone but Bush. And what you want to do instead of defaulting is you want to try to, I'm just going to give you a seizure, what we call flex, or probably a better way to say it is like coping skills, to communicate with the opposite in the same styles, right? So be mindful of what your responses are and then try to tailor them based on it. So if you are flexing to communicate with the opposite style, don't get stereotyped as too rigid in your particular style, because like differences can become assets, right? So it's good to sort of change temporarily and then shift back to whatever your, you know, going rate is. And then view differences as strengths, right? Because if I'm in a partnership or working on a project with somebody that is more precise, where I am unstructured, that kind of balances out, right? Like we can trade tasks and pick tasks that fit our strengths. Because if that person likes to make Excel sheets and do crazy amounts of detail-oriented work, but I like to dream up like the big picture strategy, that's perfect. Okay. The other way that you need to flex is with similar styles. And we might think this is weird, right? Because if we have similar styles, why do we need to flex? So say you get put on a team with like three other people who are exactly like you. You'll usually start out communicating really great because, oh my God, these people are just like me. I love working with these people because we all think and act alike. But then over time, because you don't have that diversity of approaches and communication patterns, that's whenever the problems start to occur, right? So you may get into power struggles, you maybe get too much of a good thing, you maybe get tunnel vision, right? So imagine like five people working together who are super detail oriented and like urgent, and really direct, right? At first, that's really awesome until we start to agree on like detail number 535 in the Excel file. And then everything like freaks out because that's too much, right? And then we're all the same way. And so what is our default reaction? To argue and debate. And so, you know, you can see where this, like, just because you're the same doesn't mean that you're necessarily going to get along. And so, you know, this is a point at which you just need to look around, size up your team, and then think, all right, like, how can I flex or cope with this by being, like, maybe a slightly different way? So anyway, here's my work style. Tend to be more or less, more indirect, more reserved, more steady going, and then I'm sort of in the middle on sort of the precise, unstructured. In my personal life, I'm ironically more precise. You should see my closet. It's organized according to Roy G. Biv, like any of you needed to know that. All right, thanks for playing along. What I want you to do is to, if you haven't done it, go back and do your inside inventory, and then you'll turn that in for your comprehension check this week. So hope you enjoyed interpersonal communication. This is just sort of these like little lessons that we, you know, kind of put in there because it's useful. It's maybe not directly tied to one of the speeches that you're going to do, but hopefully as you move through and you start working, you know, in life or in an internship or even in your like clubs and stuff here in school, you'll start to look around like on your officer team, or if you're in a, you know, a task force in, or task force, what they call it, like a group in class. If you're working on a group project, you may look around and say, oh, like Johnny's way more direct than I am. And then, you know, and then you've got like some wording to parse this and think about, you know, how it's going to play out whenever it gets stressful and the projects are due, et cetera. So hopefully it comes in handy for you. Thanks for listening. How would you flex to communicate with Dr. Klutzer? You can just write me an email. All right, cool. All right, well, thanks.